Were you actually planning on going to Transnistria? Here's what you need to know. I'm totally kidding. It's fine. It's a normal country where normal people live. Come on. So, skip ahead about half a minute if you're a first-time person who just wanted to check out what Transnistria looks like. To all you other people, welcome. First-timers also welcome, of course. In these corona times when we can't travel and we can't go anywhere, looking at the world through YouTube or, you know, the internet is becoming, I guess, more popular. At least I like looking at maps and looking at pictures of places and wondering what it's like there. So today I'm gonna be showing you what it's like in a country that does not exist, so to speak. It exists, come on. Well, let's get the primary necessities out of the way first, shall we? If you don't know where Moldova is, CFG, Transnistria is a territory between the Ukraine and Moldova, making it only accessible from either side by land. There's a small amount of bureaucracy involved in this, which is good to know beforehand. If this makes you confused, just consider Transnistria or Pridnestrovie as an actual country. They have their own borders, passport control, currency, flag, regulations, etc. So if you still feel the need to object for some reason, just call it the Grand Duchy of Pridnestrovie, okay? This means when you enter, you're gonna have to show your passport and get it stamped. If you're by car making your way back to the Ukrainian side through Pridnestrovie or Transnistria, make sure you get an exit stamp in Moldova. This may not be provided to you in Transnistria, as the exit stamp is Moldova's business and they're not Moldova, unofficially. Just bear with it, it's worth it. So I made my way from the Ukraine by rental car. The only rental agency that permits you to cross borders is Avis, at least for the moment. So when you rent your car, mention this, as they'll fix you up with the notary documents in a day or two, for which you'll pay around 70 to 80 euros for. You'll need to know the exact exiting and re-entering dates for Ukraine beforehand. So I personally drove from Odessa, Ukraine, through Tiraspol, the capital city of Transnistria, to Chisinau, the capital city of Moldova, and back. No problems, no hassle at the borders, no long lines. On the Ukrainian side, I needed to open my suitcase and the trunk, this probably because there are many people smuggling stuff for sale between the two countries. Moldova has road waivers, which is like road tolls, except you pay in advance and carry a document. You don't pay in booths like you usually do in some Balkan countries. So retrieving this document is super easy. You can get it online, and I won't bore you with the details. If you're actually going, you'll know what to do and you'll do your own research. If you still have questions, you are welcome to write them down in the comment section below. Transnistria also has road waivers, as Moldova does, which are different. The same but different, which you can purchase at the border in a small booth. They accept cash and card, but prefer cash. Once you have that, you're on your way, because it will probably be checked. The custom agents were kind enough to ask me about all of this paperwork that I needed, that I wasn't sure what I needed, and to direct me to wherever I needed to go and be, and almost like took me by the hand to show me exactly what I needed to ask for. They're very sweet on the Ukrainian side. Once you move on, you will then be checked again for entering Transnistria, and you'll get a visa for 10 hours. Or was it 12? I don't know. I can't remember. Save it in a safe place. It's just a slip of paper, and you'll need to show it again once you exit. You can get it extended, the visa, easily and for free if you intend to do more than transit. I only transited to enter Moldova and then re-enter to check out Tiraspol the day after. Now, all of this may seem like a hassle. It's fine, and they know exactly what to do at the borders. So the next day I entered Transnistria from Moldova. So I ordered a guiding tour in Tiraspol when I went, as I didn't have much time to spend there. I had looked online and found a guiding agency that spoke English and Korean and Turkish and Swedish. So I thought, man, I gotta go with this one.
And so I booked the guide who spoke Swedish, strictly out of curiosity, because, well, if you don't know, I speak Swedish. If you watched my Moldovan hassle videos a few videos back, you'll know that the timing of my visit to Transnistria wasn't problem-free. And so my guide must have thought that I was some sort of severe schizophrenic. Sorry about that. But anyways, he was cool. He was quite excited, as a matter of fact, because I spoke Swedish, and in return, I was quite excited because he spoke Russian, naturally. So we exchanged language to some degree, and his Swedish was really so much better than my Russian, though. We started off by driving into Bender, right outside of Tiraspol, and he showed me the reason why he wanted to learn Swedish, which is Karl den XII, or Charles the XII, king of Sweden since the age of 15 when until 17, 18, or something like that. It was the son of Ulrika Eleonora, which is a name which you will be familiar if you watched my Finno-Swedish tourist video. My guide had just felt like, man, that's so cool. I want to learn that language. And so he went for it. And I love that. I realized initially that's exactly the exact idea I had when I started my Russian language studies. I just thought, it's the language sounds cool, so why not? So my guide already spoke German and English, which makes learning Swedish, which belongs to the same language stem, much easier. His German sounded to me at least really good, and so did his Swedish. He kept exclaiming things like "tofsvipa" and "rulleka," to which I was like, "What the fuck?" Those are like names of specific breeds of fauna and flora. That's not the first thing you learn when you learn a language. So I was like, "What the?" But anyways, he drove me into Tiraspol, where another guide was to take over, and this new guide, she spoke Korean, which would have been so cool had I spoke Korean too. Annyeonghaseyo. She had been living in Korea since the age of 3 for some time, and then decided to pick it up there. Anyways, she was an art student, art history, so I felt like we had bunches in common. And she did this mandatory guiding tour that I paid for, and during this time I grilled her all about her studies and her life and how things are and etc. etc. Because honestly, all the things that you can tell me as a guide, I can already read online beforehand. So I'm more interested in having somebody to talk to. And there was this, we did the mandatory walk, from which you'll find, bunches of pics online, all this. Oh, there are these monuments. Oh, wow, a tank, etc., etc. And there is this building which I was told you can only take a picture of this building if the statue of Lenin is showing, right? So anyways, these guys have their own currency in Transnistria, as I mentioned before. What I didn't mention was that the coins are made of plastic. That's right, plastic. And you know what? Why not? Who says they have to be made of metal? I mean, honestly. And what surprises me the most is that they actually have a 3-ruble coin. Like, who has any nation ever, who has, which nation has ever had a 3-something bill or coin? Like, there's an expression in America that I've heard, which is, "You're about as real as a $3 bill," referring to phoniness, being, because it's a $3 something. Here's where a smarty smurf comes up to me and says, "Well, actually, I didn't, blah, 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 blah. There are $3 something somewhere else. And I learned something new. So if you do that, thank you very much." The other thing is that quite accurately to what you have read, there is this company called, no, there is the company called Sheriff in Transnistria. Sheriff, they own everything. They own everything from gas stations to like TV channels and sports stadiums. It's ridiculous. And there's not much to say about them, so I'll move on. I went into this post office to buy some stamps and a postcard and stuff like that. And I got this postcard of this building and this random kid. Like, whose kid is this? Why is it on a postcard? Anyways, at the end of the journey, the first guide, the one who took me, the one who spoke Swedish, he took me back, and at my request, he took me to a mini market to buy some booze. I wanted to buy some Transnistrian something something. And he recommended something that was called surprise brandy. His remark to this was, well, you know, the Slavics, the word surprise is always something positive. To a Finnish person, the word surprise is, well, you know, you can ask a Finn if you meet one. Honestly, this brandy was the best one I have had in Eastern Europe. In fact, it's the best brandy I can think of at the moment that I've ever had. So the next morning, I was going to drive from Chisinau back to Kiev, and I didn't want to drive the same road I came, which was through Odessa, because it's a long way. It's like more than 9 hours just to drive. And there was another road that seemingly looked so much shorter, and I suggested that to my Transnistrian guide, and he said, don't take that. And I said, why? No, you know, it's full of, you know, potholes and bumps and stuff. And I said, yeah, but I mean, I've driven in bad places. And he says, you're not gonna have any axles or wheels left if you go that road. And his motivation was, look, this is Ukraine, baby. That's not a road. And I said, okay, you know what? Fair enough. And I drove the same day for more than 9 hours, starting at 5 o'clock in the morning, back to Kiev the next day.